So the morning talk was mainly related to Nagarjuna's Madhyamaka Shastra. Now the second half of the talk, that is afternoon session, is mainly related to his other work, Vigraha Vyavartani, where he discusses pramanas. So just as Nagarjuna is critical about language and logic, he is critical about the instruments of knowledge, that is pramanas. At the time of Nagarjuna, the Nyaya school of philosophy was propounded by Akshapad Gautama through his Nyaya Sutra, which tried to systematize instruments of knowledge, criteria of knowledge, and justification and refutation of knowledge claims. Nyaya school posed a demand before all the philosophers of its time that if anyone wants to make any claim about the nature of reality, then he should present it within the framework of pramanas. This demand was not acceptable to Nagarjuna because, according to him, the framework of pramanas itself was essentialistic. Every pramana had a fixed nature in the light of which the nature of the object was determined. Nagarjuna, being an anti-essentialist, was critical about the whole system of pramanas. In Vigraha Vyavartani, Nagarjuna presents first the position of the Nayayiko opponent, who brings out a paradox in Nagarjuna's anti-essentialist position. The opponent argues that in order to know anything, we need instruments of knowledge. But if everything is essenceless, nisvabhava, the instruments of knowledge are also essenceless. Now, if the four instruments of knowledge, namely perception, inference, testimony, and analogy, are essenceless, how can they provide any basis for our knowledge of the world? As a result, how can the thesis that everything is essenceless be established? Here, Nagarjuna's answer is twofold. We use the language of knowing or establishing something through instruments of knowledge. But this language does not apply to essencelessness in the same way. The so-called knowledge or establishment of essencelessness does not depend upon instruments of knowledge. This is one part of Nagarjuna's answer. As the second part of Nagarjuna's answer, he examines the concept of pramana, instrument of knowledge, by using his reductio ad absurdum method. He raises two types of issues in relation to the concept. One, how is one instrument of knowledge established in terms of other instruments? A simple version of the issue is truth of one cognition dependent upon truth of another cognition? That is, what is relation between one cognition and another cognition, in other words? Who are their truths related to each other? And second is, how is an instrument of knowledge established in terms of its object? A simpler version of the issue is truth of a cognition determined by the existence of its object? So what is the relation between cognition and object? So what is the relation between one cognition and another cognition? And what is the relation between cognition and object? So cognition in relation to other cognitions. Nagarjuna elaborates the first issue as follows. If truth of one cognition is determined by that of another, and by applying the same rule the truth of other cognition is determined by the truth of the third, and so on, then this will go on ad infinitum, that is, there will be infinite regress. Or if truth of the cognition C1 is determined by the truth of C2 and so on up to CN, but the truth of CN is determined by that of C1, then again there will be circularity. Finally, in both the above cases, the truth of C1 will not be determined at all. There is another way. One might say that some cognitions are self-evident. They are like fire, which while illuminating objects, illuminates itself. Against this claim of the opponent, Nagarjuna has the problem with the so-called self-illumination. According to him, fire does not illuminate itself in the sense in which it illuminates objects. Illumination of an object implies two stages, that is, one, the object was in dark, and two, the darkness is removed by fire. But when we say fire illuminates itself, we cannot imagine two stages of this kind, that fire was in dark and then darkness was removed by the fire. So this is one part of his argument, that you cannot establish the truth of a cognition either on the basis of self-evidentness or on the basis of other evidentness, that is, the truth of one cognition is determined by another cognition. This kind of determination is also not possible. Now, cognition in relation to its object. Here, Nayayika or whosoever accepts Pramanas might say that truth of a cognition is not determined by another cognition, but by the object of that cognition. A cognition is true if the object manifested by it exists. It is false if the corresponding object does not exist. For instance, cognition of real water is true, cognition of mirage is false. Nagarjuna thinks that there is obviously circularity in this kind of thinking. Because after all, how is it determined that the object of a cognition is real? It is on the basis of its cognition. Hence, truth of cognition is determined by existence of its object, and existence of the object is determined by truth of its cognition. A question may be asked, if things are devoid of any essence and even the so-called means to knowledge are devoid of any essence, how does Nagarjuna apprehend this truth, that essencelessness? How does he know it at all? If he does not accept inference as a means to knowledge, how does he establish this truth? So either two pramanas are basic, perception and inference, either he should perceive essencelessness of things, shunyata of things, or he should be able to infer shunyata of the things. But for that he has to accept pramanas, but he is not accepting any pramanas. So this is precisely the point, Nagarjuna would say. At the level of realization of truth, there is no apprehension of anything. So realization of shunyata is something very different from realization of the so-called real things in the world. Realization of shunyata is not realization of an object which has shunyata as its characteristic. That is, simply we do not apprehend anything. There is what is called non-apprehension, anupalabdhi. When we try to find that something which has essence, we don't find anything, that's all. So at the level of realization of truth, there is no apprehension of anything. Moreover, Nagarjuna does not have any case which he would argue for. Now, coming to inference, inference has a particular pattern. You first state pratijna, that is declaration, then you present some reason, and then invariable concomitance, the statement of invariable concomitance. I mean, we have seen that, and ultimately conclusion. So, if at all shunyata is to be established, then first one has to make a declaration. Things are shunya, things are devoid of any essence, because so and so, and there is invariable concomitance that whatever has that characteristic is shunya, for example, and so on and so forth. And this should be the argument pattern. But he is saying that I am not making any declaration at all. If I make a declaration, then you can find some fault with it. You can find out some fallacy in my argumentation. But it is not a matter of making any declaration at all. Shunyata is not established through any declaration, reason, and so on and so forth. So that is, again, an important point in the context of Madhyamika philosophy. That in Madhyamika, it is said that there are two schools. One is called Prasangika Madhyamika and the other is Swatantrika Madhyamika. Prasangika Madhyamika means which uses only negative method, that is the method of refutation, the method of reductio ad absurdum type of method, finding that is given a particular view, these are the consequences, they are not acceptable, therefore the view is not correct, that's all. There is no positive proof of so-called shunyata. There is no argument, constructive argument, which proves that things are shunya. This is the prasangika school. This is what prasangika school of Madhyamika Buddhism says. And generally it is held that Nagarjuna was a prasangika. The other school is called Swatantrika, according to which one can present some independent arguments in order to show that things are shunya. For example, things are essenceless because they do not have any swabhava, and so on and so forth. One can give arguments for proving essencelessness. That was the Swatantrika school, and in history it is said that Bhava Viveka was a Madhyamika philosopher who belonged to this Swatantrika school of Madhyamika Buddhism. Now here this is a statement of Nagarjuna which clearly shows that he was a prasangika. He was saying that I am not making any declaration, I am not giving any constructive proof of shunyata at all. If I would have made a declaration, then there was a possibility of my being at fault. But I have not made any declaration at all, hence I am not at fault. We have seen in yesterday's lecture that according to Nyaya, an argument should run into five steps. The first step having being declaration of what one wants to prove. This declaration is that of the thesis and has propositional form of subject predicate nature. Subject of the thesis refers to the property bearer, and predicate refers to the property which is claimed to be borne by the property bearer. For example, in the stock inference, mountain has fire because it has smoke. So mountain has fire will be the declared thesis. Here a general rule about declaration of the thesis is that the existence of the property bearer is accepted by both the parties. That is, when you are arguing, I state the declaration, the thesis, that say mountain has fire. Now suppose I am arguing that mountain has fire, but the other person does not accept the existence of mountain at all, then there is no point in arguing further at all. I mean, so the property bearer should be accepted by both the parties. There can be dispute about the property which is to be proved. Whether mountain has fire or not, about that there can be dispute. But whether there is mountain at all, about that there should not be any dispute, in order that the argumentative exercise continues. So here, suppose in the above example, existence of the mountain is granted by both the parties. The question is whether the target property, namely fire, exists in the mountain. That is precisely sought to be proved. Now let us see whether the same policy can be applied in the case of essencelessness or emptiness. Let us imagine that Nagarjuna wants to prove that everything is empty. Then his declaration would be of the form everything is empty, where here everything is the subject term which refers to the property bearer, whose existence should be acceptable to both the parties, that is to Nagarjuna and his opponent. In this case, the opponents may readily accept the existence of everything, but Nagarjuna himself does not accept it. If he accepts, then emptiness itself will be vitiated. That is the reason why Nagarjuna cannot make declaration of his thesis. So simply says that I cannot make a declaration. It is interesting to note that Nagarjuna's above statement from Vigraha Vyavartani itself has inferential form. Only if one makes a declaration of his or her thesis, one can be at fault. I have not made any declaration of a thesis, therefore I am not at fault. So this itself is an argument, this itself is an inference. So here we come across a paradoxical situation. Though Nagarjuna is critical about language and logic, he is himself using language and logical arguments in his philosophical presentation. How does it become possible? It may be pointed out that it becomes possible in Nagarjuna's framework because his distinction between conventional truth, because of his distinction between conventional truth and ultimate truth, lokasamvriti satya and paramarthatah satya. As he says in Madhyamaka Shastra, the Buddha has presented his teachings by following two truths, conventional truth and ultimate truth. This two truth theory, however, cannot put full stop to the issue, because Nagarjuna himself arranges the two truths in a hierarchical order. That is, although sometimes it gives an appearance that he is talking about two truths, so Buddha sometimes speaks in terms of lokasamvriti satya, sometimes in terms of paramarthika satya, and one has to understand this distinction as if these two levels of truths are different and independent levels. But that is not so, because there is a kind of hierarchy between the two truths. Accordingly, conventional truth is not truth in the strict sense of the word, because it is called just conventional truth. That is what is accepted as truth, not it may not be really truth. So it is rather delusive truth, though conventionally it is accepted as real truth. In fact, Nagarjuna's whole argumentative enterprise is aimed at showing delusiveness of the so-called truth or conventional truth. Hence, Nagarjuna's double approach to language is in need of a better explanation. The level of conventional truth can be common sense level. The language is used here in an essentialist way, and hence it follows the rules of classical logic. Nagarjuna critically examines the common sense level. While doing that, he has to use language. The question can arise as to how it is justified. His denial of language as a whole, though it is expressed in language, is supposed to be a limiting case of language, which serves only as an indicator of the non-linguistic awareness of reality which one has to reach. It is similar to Wittgenstein's Tractatus. In the morning session we talked about that, which is made of nonsensical statements or pseudo-statements, but which serves as a ladder which has to be thrown away when one sees the reality by climbing it up. This ladder language has a different nature and role to play. About the anti-essentialist use of language, Nagarjuna says in Madhyamaka Shastra, there is a statement. In fact, one should not say that things are empty or that things are non-empty or both or neither. But it is said only for illumination. So all these, I mean, Buddha in different contexts, sometimes he says that things are shunya, sometimes he may say things are not shunya, sometimes both, sometimes neither. He should not have said anything of this kind, but he says this in order to illuminate the people. Now here the word prajnapti is used, prajnaptyartham tu kathyate, that is the expression in Madhyamaka Shastra. The word prajnapti has another meaning, an utterance without ontological import. So something is called prajnapti sat, means it is not really sat, but only for name's sake it can be regarded as sat. So that is the idea of prajnapti sat. So the prajnapti artham tu kathyate can have another meaning also. The word prajnapti has another meaning, an utterance without ontological import. So the last sentence can mean it is said without ontological commitment. However, the ultimate truth, according to Nagarjuna, is beyond instruments of knowledge, logic and language. It can be called mystical in this sense. If radical criticism of the instruments of knowledge, logic and language can be called cognitive skepticism, then Nagarjuna is a cognitive skeptic. But his skepticism does not remain at that level, but it reaches a higher level, that of mysticism. But how does this become possible in Nagarjuna's philosophy? A key concept which can throw some light on this, I think, is the concept of pratitya samutpada. Traditionally, Pratitya Samutpada, literal meaning is dependent origination, which simply means that things arise from causes and conditions. So dependence here is understood as causal dependence. So in traditional Buddhism, the meaning, traditional means early Buddhism. In Pali Buddhism, the word Paticca Samuppada, Pratitya Samutpada is used in relation to causal dependence. That is, things arise from causes and conditions. This meaning is not acceptable to Nagarjuna. Nagarjuna also uses the same term, Pratitya Samutpada, and that is supposed to be central to his philosophy. In the very first verse, he talks about Buddha who told Pratitya Samutpada. But his understanding of Pratitya Samutpada is not the same as dependent origination, where dependence is understood in causal sense. All phenomena are relative to something, and hence they do not have absolute or essential existence. So here dependence is to be understood in terms of relativity rather than causal dependence. Only then I think the concept of Pratitya Samutpada of Nagarjuna can make sense. In this way, through the development of the concept of Pratitya Samutpada, Nagarjuna criticizes the traditional causally bound conception of reality and at the same time develops non-essentialist concept of reality. Nagarjuna was probably the first Indian philosopher who presented cognitive skepticism systematically. He did this when Indian epistemology was in its primary stage. After Nagarjuna, we have two important formulations of cognitive skepticism, one by 8th century philosopher Jayarashi, about whom we will be talking in the Saturday lecture, and the other by 11th century poet, philosopher Sriharsha. We will not be talking about him more, only some references to his philosophy will be given. Now, Jayarashi, in his work Lion in Devastation of All Principles, Tatvopaplava-Simha, examines the definitions of pramana presented by different systems and shows how they are unsatisfactory. When no pramanas are established, the ontological principles which are supposed to be established through them are also not established. So in Nagarjuna, what we find is he mainly criticizes the concept of pramana, but he does not go into different definitions of pramana, because at the time of Nagarjuna, different definitions of pramana were not available at all. Even Gautama in Nyaya Sutra did not give any definition of pramana. He only gave the classification of pramanas. And therefore, we find that Nagarjuna develops, presents his skeptical arguments mainly in terms of the concept of pramana, whereas later on, when Indian epistemology developed through various systems of philosophy, see, various systems gave their definitions of pramana. So Nayayikas also, after Gautama, the commentators of Nyaya Sutra gave different definitions of pramana. Mimamsakas gave their definition of pramana. Buddhists gave their definition of pramana. So in this way, at the stage of Jayarashi, the 8th century philosopher, many systems had come forward with their different definitions of pramana. And therefore, Jayarashi in his work takes up different definitions and criticizes the concept of pramana in terms of those definitions. After that, again at the time of Sriharsha, a Vedantin philosopher of 11th century, in his time, again, there were Nayayikas who presented more sophisticated definitions of pramana. For example, there was a Nyaya philosopher called Udayanacharya. He had given a sophisticated definition of pramana. Now, so Sriharsha, when he wanted to criticize pramanas, he took up Udayanacharya's definition of pramana and criticized it. So in this way, we find that the skeptical, cognitive skepticism also developed when the epistemology of pramanas developed. So Jayarashi in his work Tatuapapalavasi who examines the definitions of pramana presented by different systems and shows how they are unsatisfactory. When no pramanas are established, the ontological principles which are supposed to be established through them are also not established. We will study Jairashi skepticism in more details when we discuss Carvaka epistemology. Here it suffices to say that Jairashi does not draw any mystical or metaphysical conclusions from his skeptical exercise. He rather prescribes the life of common sense without reflecting upon it. So actually one can compare, as I said, although there were skeptics in India, those skeptics also did not just say that we are skeptics, but they also showed affinity to some school of philosophy. So Sri Nagarjuna presented skeptical arguments, but at the same time he belonged to Buddhism, and therefore his skepticism had some implications which are relevant for Buddhism. Jairashi presented his skepticism, but he showed his affinity to Brihaspati, who is supposed to be the founder of Carvaka school. So his skepticism has had implications to Carvaka school. And lastly, Sri Harsha, when he presented his skeptical arguments, his arguments had ultimately they had relevance to Vedanta school. So now and therefore what are the implications of the skeptical arguments? That is also an interesting thing. That is, Nagarjuna, when he presents his skeptical arguments, through that skepticism, what he wants to show is that ultimately these pramanas are also pratitya samutpanna. I mean, again, they are dependently, means relatively originated, and they are shunya. And then this realization of shunyata has something to do with cessation of sufferings. And therefore, through this skeptical argumentation, we stop thinking, we stop speaking anything, and arrive at a stage where there is no trishna, no craving at intellectual level, and therefore not at practical level also, and therefore we are completely free from sufferings. This kind of implication we will not find in Jairashi, and that is partly because in we have to talk about these two realities or two truths or two levels. That is, in Nagarjuna we have this idea of two levels of reality. One is conventional truth and the other is ultimate truth. And through the critical examination of conventional truth itself, we reach ultimate truth. So there is a close connection between conventional truth and ultimate truth in this way. Whereas in Jairashi, there is no attempt to go beyond conventional truth and reach so-called ultimate truth. For him, for Jairashi, you have to stop at conventional truth itself, and if you reflect upon it, then there are problems. So don't reflect upon them. So acceptance of conventional truth without reflecting on them, that is how Jairashi talks about this conventional truth. And Sri Harsha, in his work, which is called Khandana Khanda Khadya, A Tasty Morsel of Refutations, starts with the justification of negative debate, Vitanda, in which one of the parties only refutes the other party's position without presenting its own. Negative debate is the official methodology of the skeptic. So here, of course, some background about the theory of debate is relevant. Nayayikas had talked about debate, types of debate, and they talked about three types of debate. One is called Vada, the other is Jalpa and Vitanda. That is, one is just friendly debate, where there is no question of winning over the other party or refuting or defeating the other party. So no question of winning and defeating, only give and take of knowledge. So even if you find a fault in the other person's argument, it is not to be taken as the defeat of the other party. Through this discussion, you have to learn. The main objective is to learn. The second type of debate is called jalpa, where there are two parties. Each party has its own position, and every party tries to prove its own position and tries to defeat the position of the other party. That is called jalpa. A hostile debate where both want to win and refute the other party, defeat the other party. And then there were the rules of such a debate, and there was a middleman who, a judge who would judge the plus and minus points of both the parties and ultimately give the decision and all that. So that is the second type of debate. And the third type of debate was Vitanda, where one party had its position, but the other party did not have its own position. The other party only claimed that whatever you are arguing is not correct. So I will only find fault with your argument. I am not going to prove anything as my own position. This is the third type of debate, and Nayayikas held that sometimes you can, or you should rather, use this type of debate also in order to protect your own doctrine. That is, you don't present your own doctrine, but you find the other you only attack the doctrine of the other party. So that is a kind of defense mechanism, and that can be sometimes used. That is what Gautama himself says, that sometimes you can use jalpa, sometimes vitanda. Now here, Sriharsha, in his work Khandana Khanda Khadya, he starts with justification of vitanda as legitimate way of debating. Because about vitanda, the question was whether there should be certain norms, certain criteria which are acceptable to both the parties. In vitanda also, there should be both the parties should accept pramanas, for example. Certain rules of debate and also pramanas, because on the basis of pramanas, one can prove something, one can refute something. Now, a skeptic doesn't want to accept any pramanas. Now, how can he enter into debate with the other party at all? That was the problem. And Sriharsha tried to show that one can enter into vitanda without accepting pramanas. It is to be taken as a kind of game where there will be rules, of course. One can accept certain rules of debate, but that does not mean that one has to accept pramanas also. So accepting pramanas and accepting something just as a rule, conventional rules of the debate. So conventionally, you may accept something, some rules of debate, which are applicable to both the parties, but it is not necessary that one should be asked to accept pramanas also. And in this way, he tried to show that vitanda can be a legitimate method of debate, where one party may accept pramanas, but other party may not accept pramanas at all, and the other party may try to disprove all the pramanas. Now, one can say that a negative debate is the official methodology of the skeptic. That is, one can distinguish here between application or using vitanda just as a kind of strategy, and using vitanda as a philosophical method, serious philosophical method. That is, a skeptic would say that vitanda is the only proper philosophical method that I can use, because I cannot establish any pramanas. I can only refute what the other party is saying. I cannot participate in jalpa, where the other party has one position, I have another position, and of course Vada also is not possible in a sense, because in Vada also both the parties have to accept some pramanas. So this is, I mean, I elaborated on this because there is no other place to discuss Sri Harsha in our scheme of lectures. He, that is Sri Harsha, then takes up the latest definitions of pramanas presented by philosophers of different schools of his time and refutes them one after the other. By refuting all means to knowledge, he tries to show the undeterminable, that is anirvachaniya, character of the whole discourse of knowledge and its objects. Pramana, prameya, vyavahar. Pramana means to knowledge, prameya, objects of knowledge. So all the whole discourse of means to knowledge and objects of knowledge is anirvachaniya, undeterminable, according to Sri Harsha. And by refuting all pramanas, this is what we can show. However, this, according to Sri Harsha, does not amount to refutation of everything. So, the ultimate reality, namely the pure consciousness or Brahman, according to him, is beyond the duality of knowledge and its objects and does not get refuted, even if all knowledge is refuted. So, this is how Vedanta can become relevant to skepticism, or skepticism can become relevant to Vedanta. In Advaita Vedanta, what is accepted as ultimate reality is the so-called pure consciousness, and this pure consciousness is identified with Brahman. And now this pure consciousness is beyond pramana and prameya, because pramana and prameya deals with consciousness, all right, but that consciousness must be consciousness of an object. So when we have knowledge, means to knowledge, and objects of knowledge, then we have this pramana prameya vyavahara, that is the discourse of pramanas and prameyas. But beyond pramanas and prameyas, there can be something. Pramanas and prameyas do not exhaust the reality. That is what Sri Harsha is arguing. Because pure consciousness is something which is, according to him, presupposed by all pramanas, all intentional consciousness, so to say, consciousness which has intentionality. That type of consciousness presupposes pure consciousness, objectless consciousness, but it cannot be established on the basis of that. It does not come within the realm of pramanas and prameyas. It is something which is at the back of pramanas and prameyas, but it is not something which can be the object of pramanas and prameyas, which can be established on the basis of pramanas and prameyas. So this is something which you cannot deny, but you cannot prove also. This is the status of so-called pure consciousness, according to Sri Harsha. But at the same time, he also identifies that pure consciousness with the Brahman of Upanishads. So existence of this pure consciousness, according to him, is self-evident. In this context, Sri Harsha sometimes refers to Vedic authority also, because when it comes to, there is pure consciousness, that's all, but nothing more can be said about that. If you want to say something more about that, what is the relation of that pure consciousness with the world, for example? Vedantins want to say that it is Brahman, and it is the material cause of the world, or it is the foundation of the world. But all these things cannot be established purely on the, because there are no pramanas, so ultimately he has to take recourse to Vedas. Sometimes he refers to Vedas in order to establish the nature of that pure consciousness. And in this way, his skeptical argument becomes subservient to his Advaita Vedantic program. It should be noted here that, like Nagarjuna's distinction between two truths, namely conventional truth and ultimate truth, Vedantins and accordingly Sri Harsha distinguish between practical reality and ultimate reality. Vyavaharika sat, and paramarthika sat. Hence, the epistemic and linguistic discourse, though questionable from ultimate point of view, is acceptable at conventional practical level according to both of them, that is both Nagarjuna and Sriharsha. However, though both Nagarjuna and Sriharsha deal with the dialectics of Vyavahara and Paramartha in a similar manner, the two skeptics fall apart on the question concerning the nature of the ultimate truth. For Nagarjuna, ontologically, the ultimate truth does not refer to something beyond or isolated from the conventional truth, because the realization of the essencelessness or essenceless and empty nature of the conventional truth is itself the realization of ultimate truth for him. So ultimate truth is not something beyond conventional truth. When you realize that this conventional truth is empty, that itself is realization of ultimate truth. You don't have to go beyond or behind the conventional truth. That is, it is just realization of conventional truth as empty. That is the realization of ultimate truth. Sriharsha, on the other hand, believes in the eternal and ultimate reality of pure consciousness, which exists independently of the conventional or practical reality. Sriharsha compares his position with that of the idealist Buddhist. The idealist Buddhists accept non-dualistic pure consciousness as the ultimate reality, and Sriharsha, as a Vedantin, agrees with that. He, however, differs by accepting pure consciousness as the eternal, all-pervasive reality, which is the same as Brahman. Here it seems to be obvious that the Brahman as the ultimate reality articulated in the Vedic Upanishadic scriptures does not necessarily follow from the skeptical negation of the subject-object duality. Here Vedantin has to take recourse to the faith in the Vedic scriptures. Sriharsha's skepticism can be regarded as what is called the, in Western tradition, fideistic skepticism, which combines skepticism with faith. That is, there were, I mean, I just read it in encyclopedia, that there were some skeptics, some religious skeptics, who correlated the skeptical arguments with faith. So similarly, here in Sriharsha, we find a similar type of a skeptic. Nagarjuna's skepticism does not take recourse to faith in scriptures, although he himself may have faith in what Buddha says, but he interprets it freely in such a way that it supports his skeptical arguments. But it tries to derive a kind of abstract metaphysics, the metaphysics of essencelessness or emptiness. This insight into emptiness naturally flows from skeptical exercise, when one realizes that no knowledge claim can be established and nothing can be established to be either real or unreal. This insight into emptiness liberates one from the attachments and cravings of life. Hence, Nagarjuna's skepticism, though it involves rigorous intellectual exercise, is not an academic skepticism, but it has relevance for the problem of life. For this reason, Nagarjuna's skepticism can be called a concerned skepticism. As a concerned skepticism, Nagarjuna's skepticism can be compared with that of Sextus Empiricus, according to whom the skeptical argumentation tries to lead mankind to the goal called ataraxia, unperturbedness. In Sextus Empiricus, a contrast is maintained between adhering to judgments dogmatically on the one hand and suspension of judgments on the other. To try to judge beyond appearance and to gain knowledge in the dogmatic sense, according to Sextus, leads to frustration and worries. Suspension of judgment, on the other hand, leads to peace of mind and relief from the dogmatic disease, rashness. According to Nagarjuna, to judge something as existent leads to eternalism, and to judge something as non-existent to nihilism. Both are expressions of fundamental craving and hence lead to suffering. He also refers to an essentialist or dogmatic viewpoint as a kind of disease, and realization of emptiness as freedom from the disease. It may also be interesting here to see the differences between Sextus Empiricus and Nagarjuna. While responding to the charge that skeptical argument may make living impossible, Sextus Empiricus held that he was not doubting the world of appearances, and that one could live peacefully and undogmatically in that world by following natural inclinations and the laws of customs of society. Nagarjuna's defense was different. Appearance and reality are not the basic pair concepts in his scheme, as are the concepts of conditional and absolute, that is pratitya and apratitya, essential and non-essential, saswabhava and niswabhava. So he would accept everything as conditional and non-essential and deny its status as absolute and essential. Secondly, though Nagarjuna may accept customs, traditions and natural inclinations as conventional truths, loka samruti satya, he may accept them only provisionally and superficially. The realization of the ultimate truth, paramartha satya, in his scheme, does affect the acceptance of the conventional truth. Here the approach of Sextus Empiricus of accepting customs and natural inclinations at their surface level brings it closer to Jairashi rather than to Nagarjuna. Since Jairashi accepts worldly practices without reflecting on them, whereas Nagarjuna examines them critically and brings out emptiness of them. That's all. Thank you.